Yeah, actually, I am going to infect you. I'm going to give you permission to make mistakes. Did you know that human beings were built to take risk? And I'm actually going to tell you that categorically. I know that for many of you, probably the majority of us, life has taught us to shut up, sit down, and just stay in the background nice and quiet, okay? I know that life has taught you to be silent, but it's actually not who you were. It actually isn't who you are. It's not. I know this because I know that you were built for the life of faith. I don't know if you've ever... How you going, Kath? Just saw you sitting there and just... I'll just randomly just say hi to people just during... How you going, Peter? Slava Bog, brat. Yep. This message will not be kapusta. Okay. All the Russians just thought that was very funny. And everybody else has no idea what I just said because I just said this sermon would not be cabbage. And and Jesus is just saying, well, it's starting off pretty shaky. There's that smell in the air. Hey, have you ever heard preachers talking about faith and they'll say faith is spelt R-I-S-K? It's what God is about. God is about risk. He took a risk with you when he saved you. He took a risk when he sent Jesus to planet Earth. He took a risk when Jesus hung on the cross for you. He took a risk when he created us in the first place. He is all about risk. He takes risk at every single step of the moment because he is all about faith. Love believes all things. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians 13, doesn't it? And God is love. He believes all things. I've been exploring in later life, as the grey hairs have started to pop out, I've been exploring actually what makes the difference between me and Christine in our parenting. Because if you know Chris, then we're significantly different to each other. And I don't want to get into all the nuances of whether or not things are, you know, are genetic or whether or not they're learned by society. But in my family, there are some general traits of a difference between dad and mum. I love the fact that Christine is not like me. I really am quite excited by that fact. I sometimes feel sorry for her that she wakes up beside this every morning and, you know, and I don't get what it is that I just don't get women. I'm just putting that out there. The men understand it. It's just... But I've noticed this, that there is a difference between how Chris mothers the kids and how Ian fathers the kids. And now I don't know if that's just because it was an Ian-Christine difference or if it was a dad-mum difference. But mum, in my world, mum is much more nurturing than dad is. That's not to say that dad's not a nurturer, but mum worries about sustainability and sleep, and dad is actually about risk. Dad is about believing you can do this. I believe in you. You can do it. Now you can do it. You know, I've had different ones of my kids sitting down with me as they come into young adulthood, and worrying to me. Yeah, but Dad, what if I make mistakes? You know, like, and I'll be like, of course you'll make mistakes. That's part of how you will grow and how you will learn. Yeah, but I might really make bad mistakes with my life and I might choose things that aren't healthy. Yeah, you know what? Some of the choices you make, because I know you. I know you really well and I can tell, yeah, you will make some wrong choices. But I trust you. I believe in you. I believe in you. It will be the making of you. I think that in my world, that's dad sounds like that. Dad is a risk taker. And I found this, that God is just like that. He nurtures, but he also throws us into risk, into danger. So he protects us and cuddles us and keeps us from harm, but at exactly the same time, he throws us into harm's way. Jesus is just as likely to stand on a mountain and send you in a boat over in the middle of a cyclone and him not actually even be there. He's just as likely to do that. I know that some of you don't have that in your theology, that it doesn't work for you, that God would never do something like that to you. Well, it's who he is. He takes risks. Faith is spelt risk. You were built for faith. I know you were built for faith because I know who built you. I know who created you. And I know what he's like. His language is faith. If his language is faith, then he has equipped you to speak his language. It's the family language. You are built for adventure. You're built for it. You're built for it. Well, that's okay for you, Ian. You're a little bit out there. Like, look at you. You're extreme. Just, you know, some of the things that you're just crazy. You'll just go for it. When you were three, you didn't think about it. You just learnt to shut up. You were taught not to make mistakes. Where did that come from? You know, those of you who are mums and dads, when your kids were little tiny tackers and they first started to walk, you were the proudest person in the room. They were hopeless. Their walking was pathetic. You know, they're just standing there and just, they stumble their walk. And you're sitting there and you're just like, look at you. You're going extreme ballistic over the top. And what you just said is like, look at you. That really sucks. You didn't even think to say to your little two-year-old, oh, yeah, yeah, well, look what I can do. Woo! Just, you just didn't. It's not in you. You champion they're having a shot. You love the fact that they're starting to walk into your world. Heavenly Father is just like that with you. I'm just going to actually give myself permission to fail here right now. Is anyone here called Sophia? Is there a Sophia in the room? No. Okay, all right. How about Tom and Sarah? I don't have a Tom and Sarah either. Oh dear, okay, here we go. I'm just giving you a demonstration of how you get it wrong. This is how to have wrong words of knowledge. Did you know that you can lead people to Christ with wrong words of knowledge? I've seen it happen, actually, where someone just comes up and says, look, excuse me, but do you have like pain in your hip? No, why do you say that? Oh, I just felt like God was just saying that you had pain in the hip. What? Does God talk to you? Yeah, okay, just like, and before you know it. I wonder, are there nurses in this place? Could I get the nurses to stand up, please? Because I felt the Holy Spirit tell me that I needed to pray healing over you, that healing would be in your hands, that this is a day for declaration, that when you go into your place of wherever it is that you work, that you actually will be carrying presence about you. So I want you to just put your hands out in front of you so that you can receive something, as if God's going to put something in your hand. Is one of you called Jan or Janet or something like that? No? Okay, because I had a special word for that one. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I just want to, just for everyone that's standing here, they walk in something that is you and your makeup. They carry with them healing. It's in their hands. It's in their heart. God, I just pray a release right now over all of those who are standing up. I just pray a release over them that it wouldn't just be in their heart, but they would actually carry something of your presence and that you would be with them, whether they're in a theatre or in an aged care facility or caring for whoever it is that they're caring for, that, Lord, that there would be healing in them. Now, I know, Lord, that some of them, they don't have the opportunity to actually put hands on people and pray in tongues over them or anything wild like that. But Holy Spirit, would you go with them? Would you go with them? Would you go with them so that where they walk, you're walking with them? And God, may there be testimony of breakthrough. And for those that they're believing for, and I'm encouraging you because I feel the Holy Spirit has told me to encourage you to believe, to mix faith with your nursing, to mix faith with it, that you're not just doing a job. You're not just caring for those who are terminal, but there is actually an answer in God for people that you minister to. And it's this ministry. I know it doesn't look like church for you, but it's kingdom. It's kingdom. And the Holy Spirit is with you to bring the kingdom. Step into it. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. Receive it into your hands. Even if you only have the chance to put your hand on a person and caress them to give comfort to them, but do so knowing that the Holy Spirit is in that hand. And the believers will lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover. Your hand has got something to do with it. So don't hold back. Don't be afraid. The Holy Spirit is with you. And you will see breakthroughs where even the doctors don't understand what just happened in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Bless you guys. In John chapter 13, verse 23, John has this little tiny statement where he talks about himself. John was the disciple, in his language, he's the disciple who Jesus loved. Okay? So, you know, down through the centuries, John has been known as the disciple of love. Okay, well, he ends up writing the little tiny letters at the end, you know, this is love, you know, and just like, and just, you know, like love one another. He's just like, everything is about love for John, okay? And when he talks about himself in John's gospel, he's the disciple that Jesus loved. You know that when they sat down at meal tables in the ancient world, that they didn't have chair and tables. You know, it's not like the classic painting of the Last Supper where everybody's sitting at the table with knife and fork. I mean, that's just so completely horribly Western. This was Middle Eastern. And when they sat at the table, they sat on the floor and they leaned back because the table is like just on the floor. And so they lie down, and so they'll typically be down like this, and the food will be here. Well, it's actually not that way around. I'm doing it the wrong way around, because if you know anything of the non-Western world, then you don't eat with your left hand. That's pretty rude. It's just dirty. So let's get around the right way, and so that you could eat here. So what they'll do to fit everybody around the table is they'll have the food here and they'll be like this. So now if someone is sitting beside me on that side, I can talk to them, but it's actually easier to talk to people around this side here. John used to sit here while Jesus was sitting there. So when he used to talk to, I'm going to use you again, Tim. This is so good. Just come up here and eat with me. I know you love food. I sat on his lap in the early service. Come and sit on this side because you can be Jesus. So, yeah. They didn't hear what you just said just there. That's just really wrong. Do you remember when they were talking and Jesus was talking about, you know, someone's going to betray him And so they're all around the place. And so they asked John, because he's sitting here. He's sitting here. John, could you just ask Jesus who he's talking about? So John just goes like this. This is why John was the disciple Jesus loved. Because he often, and that's in John's gospel. This is really quite comfortable.
It is.
I'm getting an appreciation for Nikki's world now. You can go, actually, because that's starting to be a little bit weird. John would put his head back on Jesus' chest. He's that close. When John writes his gospel, he's the disciple Jesus loved. Can I tell you something, a little secret? If we didn't have John's gospel, we would know nothing of that. That is not the picture we would have got of John. Because John was a scallywag. He was a ratbag. I'm going to tell you some of the stories about John, the real John. Luke chapter 9, verse 46 through to 48. Then a dispute arose among the disciples as to which of them would be greatest. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a little child and set him by him and said to them, "Whoever receives this little child in my name receives me. And whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For he who is least among you will be greatest." I'm just reading from Mark's gospel there, from Luke's gospel. Mark actually dobs it in as to who was, what had started that dispute. What had started this dispute was that there were two boys, brothers, James and John. Oh, John, the disciple that Jesus loved. They got their mum to go and have an interview, an appointment with Jesus, and they wanted to have the positions of greatness in the kingdom. So when you come into your kingdom, you know, can James be on one side and John on the other? And just like, yeah, that's really good. And there became a dispute afterwards because everybody else is upset because they didn't think of the question first. Like, what if Jesus said yes to you know, James and John's mum and dad? And like, so they're having this argument about who is greatest. I'll tell you right now that if the senior leadership of this church and if Bill came in and because they're having a meeting, like a staff meeting, and there's, you know, there's like all of you guys are just there and you've got the elders and the board in too. You know, you've got your executive team and all the leaders from the various churches. If he walks in and you're all having this absolute argument, he's probably going to think to himself, boy, what's going on? Like, this is not good. Like, what is happening here? So he listens in on the conversation and he starts to realize, hang on a second, you guys are all just trying to figure out who's the best, who's the greatest. And he's just like, that wouldn't actually be a really positive experience, Pastor Bill. Like if you walked into that meeting where they're all fighting with each other as to who should have the preeminence, who should be the greatest. And so Jesus has this nice little kind word. That's James and John, by the way. James and John started that fight because they wanted position. They wanted the glory. Okay. So we read a little bit further on, verse 49 and 50. Now John answered and said, "Master, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we forbade him because he does not follow with us." But Jesus said to him, "Do not forbid him, for he who is not against us is on our side." Let me just put this into the real world. So Pastor Bill comes into the office one day, and Tim comes up to him. "Pastor Bill, look, there's a church just opened up down the street, and they're not with us. They're not a family center. So I told them that they need to shut it down." and I've already spoken to the whole fraternal because this is not good. We've got enough churches in the district as it is. There's too many already. Good night. We don't need another church. The last thing we need. He's not with us. Just like that was John. Like, now, if Tim really did say that to you, I guarantee there's a board meeting. I think we've made a mistake. Let's go and pray for Nikki. Or is he just firing her bullets? Just like, where is Nikki? I'm in trouble now. She's a tough woman. I'm scared of Nikki. She's watching everything I say. Nikki, I love you. You are so awesome, so beautiful. My favorite. You're my favorite. You're my favorite. Favorite. Verse 51. Now it came to pass when the time had come for Jesus to be received up that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But the Samaritans did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you don't know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. I think this one really takes the cake. Now, Tim is about to lose his credential for this one. Oh, okay. Alice Springs, Alice Church, they're going to do an outreach out into... Where are you going to do an outreach into? What's a nearby town? Just... Okay, that's whatever that was you just said, that's where they're going. Just like, and so Tim goes up there to help you guys set it all up, and you know, and they don't the people there won't let them come in. Okay. So Tim is just like, right. Okay. Nuclear war. Their day of visitation has come and they didn't receive it, so it'll come bad now. You know, so they're asking Jesus permission to kill a village. It's what they just said. I'm serious, that's actually what they just said. Could we call down fire from heaven like Elijah did? They didn't receive you, Jesus. This is John, the disciple Jesus loved. The disciple Jesus loved was all about power and position. He was all about shutting down people who didn't fit the standard form. No, this is the way we do it. We don't do it like that. Stop it. So he's all about shutting people down, exploring what God is doing in their life. And he's all about judgment. So that, well, you got one chance, I brought the gospel to you, you didn't receive it. Well, no wonder the cyclone hit Fiji. God's been reaching out to them for so long and they just haven't received it. So judgment, just like, and Jesus is just like grieved in his heart. He's just like, you do not know what spirit you are talking from. That is not my heart. And Christians talk like that, by the way. Christians, whenever catastrophe happens in the world, Christians start talking in terms of Elijah and fire falling down from heaven, and they don't hear Jesus saying, you do not know what manner of spirit you are speaking from, because you are thinking that what God is about is Old Testament and that New Testament just reinforces the Old Testament message. You've missed it completely. God was always about compassion and seeking the lost. He always was. The Old Testament tells a story that leads us to this, but this has always been his heart. I know that Elijah calls down fire from heaven, but that's because there's a system happening in the world where God is showing that we need grace and we need Savior, and if we're left to our own devices, we will never understand who our Father is. We'll get it wrong at every turn. Because we're orphans, we're lost and separated from the eternal beauty and majesty of our heavenly Dad. We will get it wrong at every turn. But because we don't know that, God takes us through like an administration, a period of time where He paints all these pictures into the world so that we could see that apart from who He is, there is nothing facing us except for judgment and fire and death. But it's not who God is. That's just to bring us to Christ. That's just so that we would come to Him and realize that it's not about our goodness. It's not about our efforts. That the world is broken and that somehow we're engaged in the brokenness of our world and we need a Savior, a rescuer. We need someone to redeem us. So when Elijah did call down fire and fire came from heaven and consumed people died. People died all the time in the Old Testament. It's to show us that death is everywhere. It's to graphically slap us in the face to show us that we need a redeemer. We need someone to die for us, because other than that, there is only a fearful expectation of fire from heaven. You don't know what you're speaking when you speak from that covenant. When you speak from that worldview, you think that that's what God was always about. You've missed it completely. He was always about redemption. He was showing you that you're in a prison cell so that you could seek to be set free by grace and grace alone. So He showed you that graphically. He showed you that there was death and judgment at every turn so that you would look for life and mercy on every occasion. You don't know what spirit you're speaking of. This is the disciple Jesus loved. Here's the revelation. From everybody's perspective, they see John. A young guy, headstrong, full of mistakes. What John sees is someone who is loved. That's what he sees. He's got a totally different picture of himself than what you and I have got. All of his friends were outraged because he's trying to grab for power. They see the mistake. I told them to shut it down. You'd be really proud of me, Jesus. Those people, there was a move of God. That's what they said, and it's quite clearly it wasn't, so I shut it down. And Jesus is just like, oh, come on. Are you serious? If they're not against me, then they're for me. Let it go. They don't have to actually be part of this meeting. That's okay. Well, I wanted to just, like, they didn't receive you, Jesus, and they should have. So I just, like, I told them off. And I cursed them in Jesus' name. And I declared, well, hell for you. And Jesus is just like, you don't know the spirit you're speaking from. When we look at John, that's what we see, the mistakes. When John looks at John, he sees the disciple Jesus loved. Because he's getting something completely different from Jesus than what he gets from society around about him. In John chapter 15, Jesus tells the story about, he says, I'm the vine and you are the branches. And, you know, every branch that doesn't bear fruit, you know, my Father's the gardener. He cuts it off, you know, and just throws it into the fire. And even the branches that do bear fruit, he says he prunes them so that they'll even be more fruitful. You know, and then he says this amazing thing in John 15:3. He says, you are clean by the word I've spoken. And what you don't realize is that The language that Jesus was speaking in, which obviously wasn't English, because we've got our word for pruning and our word for cleaning, they're two different words. But if you go back and you read this passage in its original setting, in its Greek language, Jesus is saying this. He says, "My Father is the gardener, and he cuts off branches that don't bear fruit. And those that do bear fruit, he cleans them." I suppose in English we might use the word dresses. He dresses the vine. That would be like, so for new Australians, that doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? He dresses the vine. What do you put clothes on it? And you know, but it's just our way of language. In the Greek language of this passage, he prunes it, he cleans it. So by cleaning, he's pruning. By pruning, he's cleaning. It's the same word. And he said, "You are pruned by the word I have spoken to you." I'm going to tell you something that's really going to liberate you. That's how God prunes you. He speaks to you. That's how he pruned John. I want to be first. I want to be number one. Look, here's a little child. Whoever wants to be greatest in amongst you needs to be like this. Needs, because that's what I'm about. He just pruned them. And he did it by speaking. Oh, I wanted to shut down that thing over there. And he prunes them. How does he do it? He just speaks to them. No. Whoever's not against me is for me. Got it? Beautiful. Nice and easy. Snip. Shall we call down fire from heaven? No. I need to tell you off for this one. Okay, I'm going to rebuke you. This one's really bad. That one's really bad. You can't kill people just because they don't receive Jesus. Okay, that's kind of like, that's not my way. You don't know what spirit you're talking of. I came to seek and save the things that are lost. I didn't come to kill them. Like if they don't receive me today, I'll come back tomorrow. I'm reaching out for them. I'm believing for that village. Okay, you want to kill that village and I'm believing for it. Like we're on a different page here. He pruned him. You are clean by the word I've spoken. We've got this dumb idea that God prunes us by making us suffer all sorts of atrocities and trials. We think that because a sickness has come on me and I'm battling with a cancer or something, oh, God must be teaching me a lesson. You know, like God is pruning me. You know, or just like a crisis happens in the life of the church, and people in churches can do horrible things because they're broken. People are broken, and broken people do broken things. And it's been a long time since I've been, you know, actually a part of this church here. Long time, but like when I was on senior leadership here in this church, there were occasions when broken people did broken things and hurt other broken people. And it was shocking things, terrible things, shameful things. And pastors often will end up, they'll lose a ton of people from their church, you know, because of the way that they either managed or mismanaged a particular crisis, you know. Just a little word for the congregation on behalf of your pastors. Your pastors did not sign up to deal with all of your garbage. It's not why they signed up. They signed up to love Jesus and to be about his kingdom and to see his kingdom come. And sure, they love you just like other people are supposed to love you too, but they didn't sign up to deal with all of your garbage. If they do end up mismanaging some of the rotten stuff that you end up creating in your world, it's not what they started for. They started because they wanted to pray for people and see people healed, and they wanted to preach the good news, and they wanted to declare freedom for the captive. That's what they wanted to do. They didn't want to deal with, or they weren't necessarily even skilled for it. So, of course, some of the times they will make some mistakes and they will end up hurting you, just like you hurt them. It's just who we are. We're broken people. But in this world, God takes us and He does something beautiful and precious with us. He prunes us. He cleans us. You are not suffering what is happening in your church or what's happening in your family or what's happening in your marriage or what's happening in your physical body or what's happening in your emotional world or what's happening in your finances. You're not suffering those things because God is teaching you a lesson. Because when my Father prunes, He speaks. And you hear Him, His word. And when He speaks, you hear it. And you receive it. And you are immediately different for the experience. And you will not feel condemned. You will not feel ashamed. Because when my Father speaks to you, you will feel somehow strangely honored that He has dealt with that issue in your life. You might even laugh at it, to think how stupid you were that you would think to actually call down fire from heaven. What an idiot, of course. You see, Jesus took risk with John. He took a risk with him because he was bombastic. He was loudmouth. He was probably egotistical. He was a young guy. He was only about 18. Of course he was egotistical. Boy, I remember what it was like when I was 18. It was all about me. Jesus saw beyond all of that. Did you know that in Romans 4:17, it says that God calls those things that aren't as though they are? That's what he was doing with John. John, that is not who you are. You want to be greatest, then this is who you are, servant of all. You want to see the name of Jesus published abroad, then you won't care whether it's you and your church or somebody else down the road. You don't care. So long as revival comes, who cares where it comes from? I really don't care. It can be the Catholics. They're allowed to have revival. God, bring it on. It doesn't have to be Christian Family Center. I don't want Christian Family Center to miss out, but I just care that the kingdom prospers. That's all I care. I care that lost people are saved. That's all that really matters. Yeah, but they don't do it right. They don't have the right platform. They don't sing the right songs. Who cares? If it works for them, I don't know how, but if it works for them, go for it. You know, just like, oh, look, yeah, we could never do an outreach into that area. It's just too hard. Yeah, well, if it's just too hard, then we're just going to keep going and we're just going to keep sowing seeds, because if we sow enough seed, something's going to give, something's going to break open, something's going to grow. I just figure let's just sow so much seed in a barren, rocky spot that it just takes root anyway. I come from Sydney. Sydney will teach you that you don't need any soil at all to grow massive trees. They'll grow on in a crack in a rock. And they got no problem with believing the fact that they got no dirt to live in. It makes no difference at all. There is no such thing as an impossible place. You could be camped beside hell itself. And the gospel is the power of salvation to all who believe. The people that you reach out to might have 666 tattooed over every square centimeter of their body. And my Jesus seeks and saves people just like that. He loves to grab hold of Satan worshippers and turn them into born-again demon defeaters. Just like he just loves it. He delights to take people out of darkness and clothe them with light. He calls those things that aren't as though they are. It's who he is. So he calls John. He says, this is who you are. You're a son of mine. You carry my inheritance. You carry my DNA. You have my culture. We talk about cultures as churches all over the place. It's a big part of leadership, and I believe in it too. But the truth is, the kingdom has a culture. And we all carry the kingdom culture. It's in our DNA, even if we're not living in it and walking in it. It is who we are. We need to start listening to what our Heavenly Dad is saying about us. That's not who you are. You are an overcomer. You're a risk taker. You can do it. Remember I started off talking about what Dad is like for a kid who's facing different choices, and what Dad says? Dad says, you can do it. I believe in you. I believe in you. Yeah, I know that you've got a few issues, and I know you've got a few struggles with some of this stuff, but you're a man. You're a woman. You're not a boy. You're not a girl. I didn't raise boys and girls in my family. I raised men and women. You know, my girls, she's fearsome. And I named her Deborah so that she would be fearsome and be someone who is a judge of her people. Sometimes I wonder whether or not I went too far. Because if you tell little kids that you believe in them, you know, they start to think that maybe Dad's right. If you knew what Heavenly Dad was saying over you, you are not insignificant. There are people that only you can reach in this world. I know that Bill could say it much better and Tim is better looking, but there are people are never going to hear Bill and they're never going to ever see Tim, but they'll know you. You. Clothed with power and dignity, full of strength and the word. Like you know your God and you know who he is. Don't underestimate who you think you are, because you're a power pack. Like when you walk into the office or wherever it is that you walk, you bring something with you. You bring a presence that's on you. And it makes a difference whether you recognize it or not. You just need to step into that. You need to just start leaning into it and believe that it's true, because that's what Dad says about you. Dad says you're awesome. Dad says that you're incredible. Dad says that you can do this. Dad says, of course you can be healed. Of course you can. I know that that's incurable. That's what the doctors say. But incurable is curable if you can believe. And I believe. And I believe you can believe, because you're my son, you're my daughter, you're built for this. You're built for this. Rise up. Your family who don't know Christ, rise up, believe for them. Your bodies that are broken, rise up, believe for them. You don't have to wait for the pastor to pray for you. You have the power of God on your hand. Believers will lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover. I prayed for a group of people once. There's about 80 people, and we didn't have time to do ministry, so we didn't know what to do. So I just said, "Oh, look, everybody who's sick, just stand up. Just put your hand where it's sick. You know, don't pray for anybody else. Just put your hand on. The Bible says believers will lay hand on the sick and the sick will recover. Are you a believer?" And they're just like, "Yeah, I'm a believer. Well, the Bible just said the believers will do this. So here, be healed in Jesus' name. Go and check it out. I mean, that was my prayer. It was about as long as that. And all these people completely, totally healed. And I thought that they were just lying to me, because it's just like, well, you can't have that many people get better when, like, there was no ministry time. And so I thought I'd shut it down. And Jesus said, "No, whoever's not against me is for me. Let it go. See, explore this. Little girl came forward, and I've got my hand on her shoulder just praying for her. This is only just last year, November. Praying for her, little girl, probably about 8 years of age. I don't understand the language, so I've just got my hand on her shoulder just praying in tongues, and the mother is telling the interpreter what's going on, and so he says she can't hear. I'm like, oh, okay. So they pick the girl up, and so I sort of like just wanted to find out just how deaf she was, whether it was both ears or, you know. So I just went like that, and she goes, huh? And I'm thinking, yeah, okay, so maybe you saw me do that. So I put one hand here so that she couldn't see, and then I did it again. She goes, uh-huh? And then I thought, well, okay, so I brought it out here. Uh-huh? And I put it right out here and did it about this loud. And she goes, uh-huh? And I'm just like, oh, it must be the other ear. So I did it for that one. And each time she's just laughing and just like, I'm just like, I don't understand this. I felt like when they're believing for Peter to come out of prison, and he's just come out of prison, and he can't have just come out of prison because we're praying for him to get out of prison. So how can he be here out of prison if we're praying for him to get out of prison? Like, if we're praying for him to get out of prison, it's because he's in prison. So he can't be here because we're praying for him to get out of prison to be here. And so I'm just confused by this. Like, and then suddenly they all go ballistic because she could not hear a thing before. And it's just like, believers just do that sort of stuff. They lay hands on the sick and the sick recover. We just got to start believing it.